this movie we're making now is not real life. But at the same time, it's not a send-up, and it's not an imitation of anything. Her torch is going out, the snakes are even closer to her now. Indy climbs to the head of the statue. He braces his back against the wall and puts his feet on the arm.
I had been looking for action-adventure. I had been looking to do something that would take me globe-trotting. And that was one of the things I told George Lucas when I spent time with him in Hawaii in 77, which was, I really want to make a globe-trotting movie like James Bond. So I had that in my appetite. It was on my sort of horizon that by hook or by crook, I would somehow make a kind of international movie involving action and chases and big set pieces and a fantastic John Williams score. I just didn't quite know, you know, I had the template, I didn't quite have the carrier pigeon. And until George mentioned this idea that he had had about Indiana Jones.
It all really comes down to what I want to see. And Raiders especially was one that I just wanted to see the movie. I thought when I was working on Star Wars and I came up with the idea, I said, oh, this will be a fun movie, but I can't do it because now I'm going to do Star Wars and that's going to be my action-adventure movie. And so I was constantly trying to get somebody else to do it just so I could see it.
I just really expressed to George my desire to, you know, make a movie that I had been raised on. The kind of film that really had attracted, you know, my attention as a kid growing up, which was these spectacular international adventure stories that were mainly represented by these very cheaply made, low-budget black and white Republic serials.
That was the idea.
Oh, good. I just didn't understand.
We agreed a lot on movies and had the same aesthetic. And generally, I'm not crazy about working with my friends because, you know, it's like anything else, you can sort of damage your friendship that way. But Steven and I are so simpatico that it was very easy for us to work together.
And so the movie came together really fast.
Raiders of the Lost Ark was a very strong idea. You know, the basic of the idea was, you know, action adventure, cliffhanger, you know, looking for a supernatural artifact. The character of Indiana Jones is this kind of fallen archaeologist that was kind of always over his head. Once those were set, then the process of coming up with a story, the specifics of the sequences and things that actually happened to him in the process of this adventure were fun.
And what came out of Larry Kasdan's typewriter was even a better version of the movie that we pitched out in those 3 or 4 days of story meetings that I had with George and Larry Kasdan. But I think that's where it was born, and that's where it will always remain, at least in my memory, that film came to life, not so much even on the sound stages or on location, but the film came to life in the story writing process. And we all pretty much stuck to the script that we were given.
Indiana Jones.
It was inconceivable to me that we wouldn't find the right actor to play Indiana Jones, even though Harrison Ford wasn't even being talked about in those days. It was this actor, it was that actor, it was eventually Tom Selleck, and then Tom was preempted from doing our movie after we cast him because of a CBS show that we all know called Magnum P.I. And then I had just seen a cut of Empire Strikes Back and said to George, that's Indiana Jones right up there, Han Solo. Why can't he do it? And George said, no. I got my hands full with Harrison just playing Han Solo. I don't want to, you know, he's identified as Han Solo. Let's leave him as Han Solo. And I said, yeah, but he's an actor. Actors play hundreds of different characters in their lifetimes. I think he'd be a great Indiana Jones. And that's sort of how the whole process began with Harrison.
That's what I told George when I first accepted the project. I said, I'll do the movie, but I'm going to shoot it real fast.
Right.
We're not going to do 20 takes on a 14-inch dolly shot. And we're not going to spend time getting the girl's hair out of her eye every shot.
I was desperate when I made Raiders of the Lost Ark because I was coming off a movie that went wildly over budget and schedule, 1941. Close Encounters, wildly over budget and schedule. And Jaws, of course, went 100 days over schedule and was almost 2.5 times the initial budget. And so I really was ready to turn over a new leaf, and Raiders was my chance to prove to myself that I could make a movie, you know, responsibly, economically, and under schedule and under budget. And so that's what I set out to do, with a little help from my friend George Lucas, who's a tremendous producer and gave me a lot of hints and pointers on how to be prepared and how to prepare myself to be able to do this picture responsibly. So in a way, I had a lot to prove to myself after these movies that were very kind of, they were successful, but they were a little bit capricious. At least I was capricious in my looking at my budget and schedule and saying, I'm gonna need more days, more time, you know?
Friday night, if we don't get this, we don't get the shot.
If we don't get the shot, we don't get the movie.
If they don't get the movie, we're all up a creek.
Indiana Jones was always meant to be a B-movie. It was always meant to be a kind of low-cost movie.
And so by shooting a very lean movie, where I was actually in the cutting room saying, oh, I wish I had gotten that coverage. How do I speed this up? I don't have a cover shot. I don't have that cutaway, so I can't cut out those 15 seconds. What am I going to do? It was challenging, but it was a great object lesson, because by the end of the movie, I had made the picture for about 15 or 16 days under the 84, 85 day schedule. And I had made it for exactly the budget that we had committed going in. And so, you know, I wasn't thinking about making any kind of a movie that was a classic or any kind of a movie that was gonna be a huge success, although I was thinking about making a film the audience would like. But I was trying to make a movie that was fiscally responsible.
Raiders of the Lost Ark was a dream for me. The script came out better than I could possibly imagine. Steven, when he started directing, it came out even better than the script. So every step of the way, it was getting better and better and more fun and more exciting. And of all the movies I've made, it's the one that was the most fun of all.
Well, I think with the exception of The Shark and Jaws and E.T., I've only made a couple of movies where I can put the silhouette of the leading character up on the screen, just a silhouette, and people immediately know where that came from.
I think we all felt, everybody felt, that this was going to be a successful movie. I mean, it was designed to be extremely entertaining. And, you know, it seemed to work on that emotional level right, you know, from the concept.
I think that when you make a movie that is popular and then goes almost beyond popularity and becomes part of the popular culture, you kind of tend to say, I guess that kind of got under the skin of, you know, people who love movies. And that was one of the greatest, I think, aftershocks of making that movie. I began hearing the lines, and I began seeing kids playing Raiders games. I mean, it was really interesting to see that sort of happen.
It was a giant turning point in my career to be associated with the first movie, mainly because I was sandwiched between George and Steven. And, you know, certainly you hope that something great is going to come out of the relationship, and it certainly has. So when I look back on it, at the time it was very exciting, but it had to be a secret, so I couldn't tell anybody. I didn't even tell my mom that I was doing this, because George said, you can't tell anybody.
Steven put this on my desk within maybe 3 weeks after we had finished the movie 1941, and I had moved in as his assistant, and he said, read this, it's my next movie, don't tell anybody about it. And I just kept going page by page by page, and it was incredible. It's still one of the best scripts I've ever read. And from that point on, it was a real ride.
You know why the character's called Dr. Indiana Jones? Indiana is the name of George's dog.
Everyone has a positive attitude when they do something like this, and you feel that you're doing the best job you can with it, or you hope you are. But you never I never anticipate success in that order of magnitude that the first three films achieved. I was surprised by it, I was delighted by it. And I was quite happy to do each of them as they came, more than happy. I had a great, great time doing all three of those films.
So just before you make that break, it's like consideration, consideration, and choose that over this.
Okay.
I was, you know, very young in the process. So for me, when I first read Raiders of the Lost Ark, I saw Casablanca in my head. I mean, I saw a movie like Casablanca, and it turned out, you know, in a sense to be, in Steven's mind, much more of these kind of Saturday serial matinee kind of movies that he had grown up with. So I was quite stunned when I saw the film for the first time, you know, what it looked like when it all came together.
It was 1981, so I was 18 years old, and it was so entertaining. I was in Milwaukee. I grew up near Milwaukee and went into Milwaukee to see some movie that was sold out, and they were having a sneak preview of this, which I'd never heard of, and so we said, well, let's see the movie with the funny title instead. So it was the perfect way to see a movie because I knew nothing about it, never heard of it, and it was just great. So incredibly entertaining, but it was the first movie I saw where it occurred to me that someone wrote this, you know, in this case, Larry Kasdan. And not only did somebody write this, but they probably had a really great time at the office when they were doing it, because it just looked like such fun. And so it was sort of when I was starting to focus my thinking on being a screenwriter.
I didn't see it when it first came out. I left it a while. I think it was word of mouth said, hey, you should see this film, you know. And I went along and seen it, because you didn't really know what to expect. You knew it was kind of like one of those thriller, or it was a chase movie. Or, you know, I've never really gone to the pictures thinking about that. You just fancy a film.
I can't remember where I saw it. I have clear memories of seeing it. It was quite a sort of groundbreaking film, I think.
Whiskey.
The humour and the action coming together in perfect blend. You know, there are images that I still remember very clearly. I mean, it's lasted well.
I believe I saw Raiders pretty well when it came out, somewhat against my will, I have to say, because it was completely contrary to everything that I was trying to do at the time and the films that I wanted to be, and I wanted the Nouvelle Vague to reach England. And I mean, looking at it again, certainly retrospectively, there is a great deal more to them than just a simple adventure. It deals with imagination, and it was a great creation.
You could get killed chasing after your damn fortune and glory.
Maybe, but not today.
Of course, you know, everyone in my primary school class wanted to kiss Harrison Ford, but I actually wanted to be Harrison Ford. I wanted to be Indiana Jones.
Well, my dad used to watch a lot of Westerns. We'd watch a lot of spaghetti Westerns. And other than that, I don't really remember my dad watching much of anything else, except for Indiana Jones. But I was really into it, you know? He was really into it. It was like a family get-together thing. And it's like that for a lot of families. Most of my friends who've seen Indy found it through their parents.
I have a lot of favorite scenes in the first Raiders film, but I think the scene that stands out for me the most is the basket chase.
I don't have one particular moment that I can nominate as my favorite. There are lots and lots of moments that I have enjoyed seeing again.
You're not the man I knew 10 years ago.
It's not the years, it's the mileage.
I just thought, you know, when he and Karen Allen were on screen together, it was just electric. It was utterly transporting.
You don't know what they've got there.
Well, I know what I've got here.
My favourite bit in that film was when the guy came out with the sword, giving it all the large. And he went on, and Harrison shot him. Which I thought was kind of the thing he should do. It was simple, you know?
Indy shooting the guy with the scimitar instead of engaging in a bullwhip fight with him is just a moment of movie inspiration that will live forever.
I'm going after that truck.
Oh,
I don't know. I'm making this up as I go.
I have a lot of favorite scenes. I think my favorite, which was the inspiration for the whole series in the end, was the truck chase. And him going under the truck with his whip and that whole thing, which was really where the concept of this whole thing started.
I think the best set piece for me in Temple of Doom is the scene where Indy gets caught in that crusher chamber where the ceiling is coming down and the spikes come out of the hole. And Willie Scott is outside and Indy is trying to get her to find the release mechanism to reverse the crushing effect that's about to happen to him short round. And then she's got her hands full with bugs and she's panicking and freaking out over the bugs while he's trying to get her attention to put her hand in this really gross hole.
We are going to die.
Stop.
That to me, that cutting back and forth is my favorite scene in the entire movie.
He's such a man's man. He's the ultimate superhero. So when you put him in these vulnerable situations, it's hysterical. You watch Temple of Doom, anytime he get into a situation, short round, he's vulnerable. He's talking to a kid.
No mistake!
A mistake!
I'm very little. You cheat very big.
Just any vulnerability with him is funny. He's really funny.
A favorite line. Gee, there's a lot of good ones.
It was in the script, but it was the way Harrison did it when he said snakes.
Why did it have to be snakes?
And then Solid comes in, which is an equally good line, I think. Larry Kasdan wrote and said, asps, very dangerous, you go first.
I know, the dialogue's so sparkling, you know. I mean, from the first movie, Indy's line with Marion, you know, I can only say I'm sorry so many times. And she says, well, say it again.
Do you know what you did to me in my life?
I can only say I'm sorry so many times.
Well, say it again anyway.
I just love that. The third movie, remember, Connery's line, I should have sent it to the Marx Brothers. There's a million of them.
Can we discuss this later? I should have mailed it to the Marx Brothers. Will you take it easy?
My favorite Indiana Jones film is The Crusade. Not just because Sean Connery was in it, not because of that reason, it's just the subject matter, you know? And it was the first one that actually tugs in your heartstrings a little bit for me. I remember at the end with the old knight standing there, who'd been there for hundreds and hundreds of years. I actually started crying. I think that got the emotions going, that one. I kind of like that. And I like the whole thing about the father and son element in it, you know, of a son being brought to his dad and, you know, finding one another again. So that was my favorite one.
Keep looking down. Let Sean see you looking down.
Son, I lost you.
There was quite a talented group of people, and there was a real explosion in the area of the blockbuster movie kind of coming into its own, with Steven having done Jaws and George having done Star Wars and then moving into the Indiana Jones series. And they were really at the forefront of that.
But another aspect of this series that's been kind of interesting to me is that the number of filmmakers today, younger filmmakers, that come up to me and say, well, the Raiders of the Lost Ark was, you know, why I got in the movie business, and talk to me about how they watched it in film school and how they learned so much from it, how Steven shot that and the action sequences, and the rest is history.
Lost Ark, Bellick's head blows up, Dietrich's head shrinks, and Tote's head melts right down to the skull. And so, you know, I said, fine, how are we going to do this? I had no idea how we were going to pull this off. So I certainly had the actors pose in the different positions. I had Bellick scream, I had Tote scream, I had Dietrich scream, and that's all ILM had. And it was up to them to go off and bring back to me an effect that was suitable. And I was amazed, especially at the melting head. I thought that was one of the most amazing effects I'd ever seen. And I love as the hat no longer fits him, but comes lower and lower and lower as the face drops away. It's pretty gory, pretty gross, but I love that effect.
When it was brought to me and said, "We, you know, let's do the melting bit on it," I kind of said, "Okay, there's got to be a way to do that." I'd never done it before, hadn't really done anything like it before, and didn't know anybody who'd done anything like it before. And the interesting thing is the guys at Kerner Optical, which is the sort of model shop, creature shop, now separated from ILM, they're going through a simplified version of what I did to illustrate the basic steps of the process. And they'll be doing the casting an actor to get the negative mold, they'll be doing an underskull, they'll be doing the layers of gelatin to get the same basic effect. But I'll be very interested to see how they deal with it, because it was a challenging shot.
Okay, here we go, this is a rehearsal. Laughing and turning, Ronnie.
The shot required Ronnie Lacey to have a facial cast, and I've had that done myself, and it's no fun. It's basically, you're putting this goop on your face, this rubber material.
The original makeup man on the show would have used a material we call alginate, which is a material that dentists use a lot to take impressions of teeth, only we use it to take entire impressions of the head.
So once they get that facial cast, then you have to go in and sculpt and fix and open the eyes and put eyes there and all this kind of stuff. So it was a very trepidatious experiment.
Basically what I did was I took the negative mold, which was the face of the character, and the underskull had to be made out of stone to withstand the heat, and I had to sculpt it to actually sort of match the negative image of the character. And then I left a space in there for the dimension of the skin. I had worked with gelatin before and knew that it melted at a and was still very thick. So I decided to go with that. And what I developed was a formula for the gelatin so that it was extremely delicate. It melted at a very low temperature. But it also didn't last very long, which caused a lot of concerns. And the way it worked was that I painted in very thin layers of gelatin every step of the way, each one a little bit different color. And as I did so, I would layer in veins. Some veins were made out of literally colored yarn soaked in gelatin so that there was stuff that would be dripping off and falling off as it happened. Did the actual effect, it wound up being two propane space heaters headed straight on it, and I was underneath it with a heat gun with this hot gelatin dripping down on me, kind of like, oh, that needs to melt a little quicker over here, and so really making moment by moment adjustments.
Wonder.
even though I got the gelatin melting fairly quickly, it still was a long process. It still melted for, I think it was 10 minutes or something like that, 8 or 10 minutes maybe. And so they had to speed it up in the lab. We did the shot. It went pretty darn well, actually, I thought, because I'd only done maybe 3 or 4 full tests of different gelatin mixes before I got to this one. The other ones just melted all wrong and fell off before they were melted. And so we got really lucky on that take, and everything worked really well. And it seemed to be a pretty effective shot in the film, so in the end I was happy with it. I cannot begin to tell you how many phone calls I got about that effect. Not just people who, you know, really appreciate it or fans or whatever, but a lot of other makeup men, because everybody wanted to melt a head somewhere. And they went, so how did you do it? What was the formula? And I'm like, I should have just published it somewhere and, you know, let everybody know that way. Because I still get people who say, I love that effect. How did you do that? And, you know, it's been a long time. I think the most effective way to do the same effect today would be to do it practically the way I did it, but then computer enhance it afterwards, because there's a lot of stuff that shows up now. It shows the technique of what it was, but there's a lot, so much you can do with computers for cleaning up edges, smoothing things out, controlling compression, and a lot of the other elements that really, you know, bring it up. But you could use the same techniques to give the basic information for a computer to really embellish.
I think that Tote's melting head is one of those images, once you've seen it, you never forget it. I mean, it's grotesque and it's hideous to think about it, but once it's in the mind, it'll never leave.
I had made a deal with George Lucas on the beaches of Hawaii that he said, look, Steve, if you do this first movie, you've got to do 2 more. You've got to do 3 altogether. And I shook his hand in 1977, in May of 77. So whether or not I, you know, wanted to in my heart make a follow-up to Indiana Jones, I had a handshake with my best friend. I was going to make 2 more movies. And it was a perfect opportunity to create a series of adventure films.
Indiana Jones is episodic. Each film itself is its own unique reality. And you don't really want to carry ideas over from one movie to the other. So one of the things we decided is that we didn't want to have Nazis in it. We wanted to deal with something else. And so it was easier to move it backwards than forwards in time. And we wanted to avoid, why isn't Karen Allen in the picture? You know, we loved her. You know, if it was afterwards, then you sort of have to deal with that. And if it's before, you don't have to deal with it at all. But basically, in terms of the main parts of the story, it wasn't a continuation at all.
Temple of Doom fell into George's philosophy that because in the Star Wars trilogy, you know, Empire Strikes Back was the darker of the two stories, George wanted the Indiana Jones series to follow a similar sine wave where we would dip into a kind of inner world or inner sanctum of darkness and human sacrifice with this whole Kali cult thing that George came up with for the second installment of this adventure trilogy.
With Star Wars, like any story, things get bad before they get better. And by the nature of the fact that that was one story that had been split into 3 parts, the middle part is the darkest part. In Indiana Jones, because they're separate, it was really a matter of saying, why don't we make a little edgier movie? Make it a little bit darker, a little bit more scary.
I wasn't really okay with that. I kind of resisted it. But George was tenacious that he wanted the second one to be dark, and I was worried it would be commercial enough. And it wasn't as commercial as the first one and the third one. But George thought it was an important thing that he wanted to do, and I certainly deferred to George's better judgment because he had seen this 3-movie arc, and this is what he wanted to do, and I was his director for hire. I was very happy to help realize his vision.
Wake up, Dr. Jones! Wake up!
Temple of Doom is definitely a tougher movie, but it was tougher intentionally. You know, pulling somebody's heart out, it had been done quite a bit before. And, you know, the fact that the children were in jeopardy had been done a lot before. So these weren't ideas that were, oh my gosh, we're stepping over a line here. We're doing things that people have always done. The point was is that we did it better than anybody else did, which made it even more intense.
And cut.
The action scenes in all three of these movies have been easy to come up with, but we had this big roller coaster, sort of mine train chase, actually in Raiders of the Lost Ark, in the quarry, in the big mine quarry, that I cut out because it was just too much to shoot in the time that I was given to make this movie. And that did carry over to Temple of Doom because it had been sitting out there and it was a really cool scene, so we just transplanted it from the first movie to the second movie. What we want to do is, once they hit this part, we're going to have a flamethrower. Something can shoot up from both sides of the car, back there and back there. And it was also symbolic of a lot of what the critics were saying about these movies. These are e-ticket rides, they kept saying, like a Disneyland. I guess they meant Thunder Mountain or Space Mountain. So George and I kind of said, well, why don't we give them a roller coaster ride? Let's give them an actual e-ticket ride, and that's how they get out of the darkness. You know, Temple of Doom got terrible reviews, and Raiders, of course, got great reviews, and Last Crusade got terrific reviews, but Temple of Doom didn't do very well. The reviews were awful.
It's not the most fun of the movies, and I like some of the other ones better, personally. But at the same time, I like it. You know, I'm more of a humor guy than a dark guy.
Very funny.
Ha, ha, ha.
I liked a lot of the movie, but the greatest thing that ever happened to me in my life came out of the Temple of Doom experience, and that is that the girl I cast to play Willie Scott, you know, turned out to be my wife.
Lau!
So, in a sense, I owe more than I can ever express to that experience for introducing me to Kay Capshaw. But all four of the Indiana Jones films have been a blast to make. I mean, don't get me wrong, whether the stories are dark or not, they're really a lot of fun. We have a lot of laughs. And we always have the audience in mind for these stories.
We are going to die!
Indy, why does the floor move?
Give me your torch.
A tradition that we have in the Indy series is one of creepy crawlies, of things that makes you shudder and get a little creeped out. The first one we had snakes, the second one we had bugs, and the third one we had rats.
Almost pathological fear, and it is a fear of snakes. And so it had to be part of the story.
Snakes. Why did it have to be snakes?
When I came up with the idea that he had to have a phobia and the phobia should be snakes, I only said snakes because I had just recently read a list of the top 10 phobias. I think snakes was number 3. And I think public speaking was number 1. And I remember bringing that to the story meeting when we met with Larry Kasdan and said, why don't we give him a phobia, he's afraid of snakes. So I was always looking for opportunities to bring the snakes back.
I've seen people that just cannot be on the set when we bring a snake on. They just can't physically allow themselves to suffer what's going on in their bodies, and they just remove themselves.
Feel this, feel it. Feel this. It's like kosher delicatessen food.
I think I was able to suggest snakes as Indy's phobia because I'm fine with snakes. I was raised in Arizona. We had snakes, you know, in our house. You know, they would just come out of the desert and somehow get into the house. So snakes were something that I never had a problem with.
Mike Culling was the animal trainer on the first three movies, and I've had the great pleasure of working on the last two. And of course, Mike Culling's work with the snakes on Indiana 1 is the envy of every reptile enthusiast around the world. That is the stamp. That is the one, that's the golden orb. That's what everyone is striving for, to get that one job.
Well, honestly, when I read the script, I never really thought about it one way or another. It seems a funny thing to say, but I mean, it didn't occur to me that we were going to have like thousands of snakes around us. And I think maybe the first time I said something to Steven about it, he said, oh, well, you know, we're going to have these mechanical snakes and it's, you know. And once we started shooting the film, it became clear right away the mechanical snakes didn't work, that they didn't look like real snakes. And so they had to immediately abandon that. And all of a sudden, while we were at Elstree Studio in London, this call went out for like, you know, 4,000 or 5,000 more snakes.
Get on it right now and get as many snakes here as you can within the shortest period of time. He says we get 5,000 from Hollywood in 2 or 3 days.
And all of these snake wranglers started to come in, and suddenly there were thousands and thousands of snakes on the set.
We had dozens of these containers full of all manner of snakes. We were working with, I think, as many as 8,000-10,000 snakes. Thousands of which, by the way, escaped each day through cracks and crevices. So they were constantly being renewed.
A lot of them were quite harmless snakes. They weren't even true snakes. A lot of what we worked with were actually lizards that are called glass snakes. And you can literally stick your finger in their mouth and they won't bite you.
Some of them are called glass snakes. They're actually a legless lizard. And they're actually a lizard. They get about 3 feet long. It's a European one. They get about that fat and about 3 feet long. And they are a lizard because they blink. Snakes don't blink. So you look at it and say, is it a snake? Blink. It's a lizard. We're okay. We're going to live. Now, this is the Burmese python. And this is the same species that actually came out through the skull. This one weighs only about 25, maybe 30 pounds. But after 10 minutes of holding this snake, it gets a lot heavier. Pythons are actually very nice to work with. They're pretty docile by nature. Most of them have been homegrown, they're born in captivity.
And we had some cobras that had to be handled very, very carefully. People think you can detox cobras, but you can't.
The only time I really felt a little bit in danger was when we had the cobras on the set. And you saw everybody get very serious. And we had to have the anti-venom there and an ambulance, and everybody really paid attention when the cobras came on the set.
The big event is the cobra that pops up in front of Indiana Jones. I mean, I think that is just fabulous. Cobras are my favorite snakes. These are the one snake that says, you know, surprise! Everybody hates that. They love it, but they hate it. But cobras are very polite. They'll stand up and tell you I'm here. And you kind of respect that. They're probably one of the easiest snakes to work with. If you have a cobra that wants to hold his ground, there are cobras that hold their ground and they'll hood up and stand and stare at you. That's the one that's perfect for what you need, especially for movies. Everywhere you move, the cobra will follow you. So you can see the back of him, and then you walk around behind the camera and he'll follow you. And you get a bit closer and he goes like that. And if you don't take the warning, they will kill you. Indiana Jones, the first one, of course, they use spiders as well, another one of these freaky animals that are on the top of the list of scary things that people don't like. And spiders are actually interesting to work with, and they're actually very delicate. First of all, spider tools. Aha! And I want to take this one right here. That's a shed skin. Here we go. And that is what steps out. Now, here's a Mexican South American tarantula.
blow on his butt and he goes that direction.
And you have to be very careful. You can't put too many spiders together and let them get comfortable, because they cannibalize each other.
There's something on the ground.
Few last different fortune cookies.
In the Temple of Doom, of course, instead of snakes, they went with bugs. Another one of those things that really scare the bejesus out of other people. And there's just some horrendous looking bugs in there.
That's no cookies.
One of them was actually a Malaysian stick insect. It's like, they're called a leaf bug as well. It won't bite you, but it looks like it should hurt you terribly. It's a big bug. There's black-headed centipedes, which really hurt, and they're very fast. And there's tons of stuff. There's Madagascar cockroaches, beetles of every assorted type.
Get some of that. Okay, action on the bugs.
I would say the most difficult of the three elements, snakes, bugs, or rats, were actually the bugs, because they're totally uncontrollable. But the bugs, they did creep you out, because they have those little things that get down your back and they get in your hair, and it just doesn't feel too good.
Cut. Okay, run in there, Mike.
Well, the problem with bugs is, you know, they're fast and they're small and they can escape. So it was very hard for us to keep the bugs in the confines of the set, the very small set we had built. You know, the bugs would literally be 25% less every day we shot. And they would escape onto the real estate of Elstree Studios, and then they'd eventually get into probably the ecosystem of the surrounding communities. And by the last day of shooting, we only had 25% of our bugs left.
Okay, we gotta get Robert down here. We don't have enough bugs to make the scene work.
It's actually quite funny, because people say, I want the bug to come from here to there and go up there, and it's like, you get, it's a bug. It's got the brain the size of a grain of sand if you're lucky, you know. You can actually manipulate them a little bit if you touch them on the back. Sometimes they keep moving, and you're pretty much stuck right there. In The Last Crusade, I was actually hired on as one of the reptile wranglers.
They're moving, so we pan down with you.
Yeah, so there is movement.
So we delivered, I think it was like 4 or 5 alligators.
I got this guy here trying to eat them.
14 or 1,500 snakes. Giant lizards, giant tortoises, this is all in the train. And of course, then we turned up with the lion. And this is where we put River Phoenix, set him in a box, and we put a couple of thousand rubber snakes underneath him, and he was sitting on a bucket with snakes all over him. And then on rolling, I poured 1,000 garter snakes on him. And then on action, I dumped another 400 or 500 on his head. And these are garter snakes, they're like this real wiggly little boogers, they're all over the place. And we had like 9 people catching snakes off the camera, you know. And he goes, it's a great job.
Oh, rats.
On The Last Crusade, they had rats, tons and tons of rats in the crypt, you know, all running through the water and stuff.
Can we put a few on that skeleton crawling around the guy hanging down on his head, neck, and rib cage?
I like rats, and we actually bred those rats in captivity. Those were like a couple thousand rats that were literally bred for, you know, reasons of health. The rats were bred just to be in that one scene.
For the Raiders, I was asked to get 20,000 snakes. And for Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, I was asked to get 50,000 bugs. And for this one, The Last Crusade, I was asked to get 1,000 of these sewer rats, which gradually changed over the months until the start of filming in June 88. We then had to have 5,000.
Put them on the floor and go that way.
Rats are very, very easy. They're very intelligent. Within 3 weeks, you can have rats running from A to B over a period of 15, 20, 30 feet to a buzzer. It's like calling the dog, dinner, clang, clang, dog comes in. Rats do the same thing. So the rats work for their dinner, their lunch, their breakfast, snacks in between. And if you have the set, if the set is built, you just practice on the set every day. You just go down there and you do this same routine probably 5-6 times a day.
We gave him bugs, snakes, and now rats. What do we do for Indy 4?
And in the fourth one, we have a new added element that is in line with the other three movies. But that's all I can tell you.
Well, I don't know if it's much bigger and much scarier. It could be smaller and much scarier. I don't know. It's up to the audience. We just throw this stuff out there and hope that some of it sticks to the wall.
Thank you.
Why do you seek the cup of Christ?
I didn't come for the cup of Christ. I came to find my father.
When it came time to doing Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, George Lucas wanted Indiana Jones to go after the Holy Grail. And I didn't think that was a very exciting MacGuffin. I thought it was static and it was a cup and it would just sit there. And George said, well, you know, we can do something paranormal about it. We can, hey, why don't we say that if you drink from the cup, you have everlasting life. It's like the Fountain of Youth. And I said, yeah, that's okay, George, but it's still just gonna sit there. But what I brought to the table was, I said, you know, the Holy Grail is also a metaphor, you know, and I think the Holy Grail could be a metaphor for bringing together Indiana Jones and his dad. Why don't we make it a father-son story? And it's the father who is the Grail expert, who had devoted his entire life in search of the Grail, and he gets kidnapped, and then Indy has to look for his father. And in searching for the truth, in searching for the father, you know, he closes the estrangement. So I really brought that into the story as a kind of parallel story between the father and the son and the quest for the Holy Grail. And George said, okay, fine, let's do that. And that's what we did.
Then Stephen kind of sort of got into the idea of the father, and he came up with the idea of Sean Connery. And I said, oh, Sean Connery, for God's sake, that's, you know, everybody's gonna think he's James Bond and it's gonna ruin everything. And, you know, we want somebody, you know, a character actor to play that part. And he says, no, you forget. This thing started with, and the character came out of, a love of James Bond. So James Bond really is Indiana Jones's father. And I said, okay, I guess you're right. But I was afraid that Sean wouldn't cooperate with being the old father who can't do anything, the librarian, because it's very much against his image. And when I saw those guys together, you know, Sean just took that role and made it better than it could have possibly been. And he was very funny.
Dad! Whoa. Dad! Ah, Dad!
What?
Head for the fireplace!
Sean was only playing older to be his father. In fact, they're closer to age than most people realize. And we had a lot of laughs behind the scenes about that. But I just thought that this relationship would be successful if I could get Harrison to call his father sir, and at one point in the movie say, yes, sir. And that was going to define the rest of the relationship. There was the pecking order. And in that first scene, when Harrison gets knocked over the head by that vase and falls to the ground and leaps to his feet, almost standing at attention.
Yes, sir.
That was, for me, the beginning of a beautiful friendship and a beautiful relationship with a lot of abyss to be closed.
Jesus Christ.
That's for blasphemy.
The father still has all the authority, and it worked beautifully, because it could have very easily been the, you know, Indiana Jones sort of overrunning the part and being the big tough guy, and the father being weak. And because of the nature of Sean Connery, it had a beautiful balance.
Junior, you did it.
Junior!
Junior? It is you, Junior. Don't call me that, please.
But the father only refers to his son as Junior, and never calls him by name. And I wanted at the very, very end of the movie somewhere for the father to turn and say to the son, Indiana. And I wanted that to be where the son had to make the choice between losing his life or recovering the Grail. And this father uses the word Indiana, the name Indiana, to get Indy's attention off the Grail and back into eye contact with the dad.
I can almost reach it, Dad. Indiana.
And then he says to his son, sort of, he says to his son, you know, give it up. You know, life is more important. You know, this relationship is more important. And then Indy gives the father his other hand. And those were the two big measurements, I think, that came before a lot of the story. That was just, those were big brushstrokes to kind of figure out, okay, if we've got yes, sir, at the beginning, and we've got that at the end, how do we fill in the middle?
The relationship between Indy and his father had a real powerful impact on the movies, because before there was character, but it was mostly action driven. And the fact that we could do one which is essentially a character piece with some action in it surprised people.
I thought I'd lost you, boy. I thought you had to, sir.
I remember actually going into a couple of theaters opening weekend and hearing the audience laughing. I think it was, in a way, it was the funniest of the three. It got many more laughs than Raiders of the Lost Ark got. And of course, many more laughs than Temple of Doom, which didn't get that many laughs at all. But I thought in terms of audience participation, the most successful of the three movies, if you just listen to the audience laugh and clap in certain places as the movie, you know, went along, was The Last Crusade. I got a chance to work at the beginning of Skywalker Sound with the father of Skywalker Sound, Ben Burtt. And I remember the first time I was really flipped and so impressed by something Ben did with Raiders.
The Jovitos are near. Poison is still fresh, 3 days.
All of a sudden, there is a strange, otherworldly creature, almost a Star Wars creature. I don't know where he got it. And it made that entire jungle scene so friggin' alien. And when I first heard that, I said, this is going to be a great adventure. It's going to be a great adventure in sound.
I had a conversation, a long conversation with Steve over the phone about the nature of the whole film.
You'll come back here for the chair.
I think I said to him something about the fact, well, does the hero's hat stay on all the time? And he said, yes, it does. And then I understood what kind of movie we were making. You know, if the hat never comes off, even in a fist fight, then we're in that realm of the classic Saturday afternoon adventure movie. We knew that Indy had a whip. And, of course, we could have pulled the whip sounds from a library, since obviously there's been whips recorded in the past. But no, we wanted to do it ourselves. Actually, what happened was that Gary Summers, who was recording sound effects with me, spent the day on the set. And the result of that was that Harrison had some time and came over to our editing room. And Gary and Harrison stood out back in the parking lot, and Harrison tried to show Gary how to crack the whip. It was a little too noisy to record it. So later, I took Gary Summers out to quiet locations. And Gary did a lot of cracking of the whip. And we did it in different environments, in the trees, out in the middle of the field. And we built up a library of whip cracks, which was the basis for Indy's sound. A gunshot can just be a pop or a click, depending on where you record it, because it's just a sudden, very brief, loud noise, like a hand clap. The actual Indiana Jones gunshot was a 30-30 Winchester rifle that was recorded. We did a lot of different gunshots. We probably recorded, you know, a few hundred different guns in different locations. Of course, we would pull the best from that, but the Indiana Jones gunshot wasn't, you know, processed or really manufactured in any way in the studio. It was pretty much exactly as it is in the live recording we did. The giant boulder was a tricky sound to invent because it had to have weight, but it also had to accelerate and move very fast, and finding something that big and getting it to move fast was hard. We had several different sessions where we went out and tried to stage a boulder sound, and they were not successful. But on one of the last days, we were coming back from the location, and we were on a steep hill, and we were in this little Honda Civic station wagon on a gravel road on this mountain, and we were just coasting down the hill without the motor running, and we realized that the car sounded really interesting. Well, we might have the sound here. So I hung out the back and put a microphone near the back tire of the station wagon, and we just coasted down this road. And as the car accelerated, it gave a sense of gathering speed, and it, that ended up being really the basis for the giant boulder. The body blows and punches in the Indiana Jones films was another area that we worked hard and tried to come up with a new sound. Although many of the sounds really, I think, were based on what we had heard in older films, the classic sound effects, but I wanted to remake them and do them in stereo and to exaggerate them probably in some ways, because everything about Indiana Jones was somewhat of a comic book. We tried a lot of different experiments. We beat on pieces of meat. We broke chicken bones. Probably we had our most success with a pile of leather jackets and a few baseball gloves, and making a loose pile of this material and then whacking it with a baseball bat. And out of that came the whole library of hits in the Indiana Jones films. There were a lot of elements that went into the Well of the Souls. Most principally was the snakes. And we started out recording some real snakes, but snakes don't really vocalize all that much. And part of the element of the snakes is really their movement over each other. And we've had a lot of luck over the years with cheese casserole. My wife makes a cheese casserole, and when it's in the dish and you just run your fingers through it, it gives a real oily, mushy sound. And if you record that and build it up in several layers, you can make a nice sense of slimy snakes moving around the room. That was augmented with some wet sponges being moved around. In fact, I think it was on top of a skateboard, on the rubber place on top of the skateboard where you stand. Certainly the most supernatural part of the film was the end sequence where they open the ark and the spirits flow out and destroy everyone. So quite a bit of sound went into that. It's obviously the kind of sequence where there's nothing to record on the set at all. It's all going to be manufactured later.
1, 2, 3, 4.
And the sequence begins with the lid being slid off the ark. And I experimented with a few different things, but I found that sliding the toilet tank cover in my own home toilet was perfectly sufficient. And if I recorded that in an echoey bathroom, it seemed to fit, although in a rather undignified way, the character of the ark itself. The ark itself, the humming, the deep undulating tones that went with it, were generated by a synthesizer. It's rare that I use an electronic synthesizer, but this was one case where I found the kind of sound I wanted. I had an old ARP 2600, which is what I used to do R2-D2. And by reprogramming it, I was able to produce some wavering, low-frequency tones, which became the basic sound. Once the ark is opened and the spirits start flowing around, there's quite a bit of work there taking animal screams and some human vocalizations, as well as dolphin cries, which we had recorded, and sea lions. And I ran those through a vocoder, which keeps a sense of the original sound but adds a musical tone that follows the same pattern as the voice. So it gave it an otherworldly quality. All the sparking and beams were from a set of recordings I made of the old gear that was used in the Frankenstein movies. It was a fabulous variety of electronic devices and lightning generators and things of that sort. And out of that came all the sounds for the beams and things. Each indie film was a new challenge because they covered so much ground. Temple of Doom suddenly had us running all around the world. So So we really knew that we needed to just record a lot of new things. And they did actually go out and record while they were on location in Sri Lanka, some animals and birds that were native to the place. And that gave us a good start. The sound effects for the minecart chase came from many sources. I started, as I usually do, by analyzing the actual sound. I mean, can we record some minecart somewhere? And that led to the possibility that maybe a roller coaster would be a good thing to record. And after a while, we actually set up at a very interesting recording event, which was at Disneyland. Gary Summers and I were allowed to go in there at night when no one was there and ride all the different roller coaster rides and record them without any music turned on or anything of that sort. A very strange night was spent there gathering some very high speed, you know, rolling cars, and then they would screech around corners and they would clatter as they went up and down. That was the beginning of a lot of the minecar chase effects. We had to augment it with a lot of things, but principally the sounds done at Disneyland was what, you know, gave us a variety of clangs and echoey, rattling sounds, which when pieced together in a controlled fashion gave us the sense of the minecart chase. And the minecart chase was a, you know, unique opportunity for us to do a high energy chase and to sustain it really with principally sound effects. And it kind of exhausted everyone on the whole crew to do that, myself included. But along comes Last Crusade, and as usual, things are amplified even more. And we have there a motorcycle chase, which goes to an airplane chase, which goes to a horse and tank chase, and kind of all in the same breath.
Oh, rats.
We always have sequences which involve a lot of dangerous creatures surrounding us. In Last Crusade, we're surrounded by rats. And like most movie animals, they don't make any noise on the set. So I needed to make up sounds for what would be thousands and thousands of rats. And oddly enough, I ended up using chickens. I had a group of irritated chickens all clucking at once. And I put them on a keyboard, the sound on a keyboard, and then played the very highest notes, which made the chickens go way up in pitch. And it made a funny kind of chirpy, well, it sounded like rats to me, and I guess everybody else believed it. But those rats were really chickens. In the climax of the film, not only do we have the whole temple moving and mechanisms and stones turning, but we have an earthquake. And a lot of those first sounds you hear of the floor splitting are really just rubbing on a balloon, you know, an inflated balloon with you're getting that squawking sound. Also, a lot of the stones falling and avalanche effects there came about because we spent a day once gathering stones and boulders and rocks around Skywalker Ranch and hauled them all the way up to the top of a big rock outcropping and then just shoved the whole thing off the cliff and let them all pour down the front of the stone. And we recorded that, and it's become quite useful over the years to have that sound for all of our earthquakes. My association with Indiana Jones has been a very pleasant one for me, creatively and for my career. I shared an Oscar on Raiders of the Lost Ark with Richard Anderson for our sound effects editing. And Last Crusade, which kind of capped the trilogy for me, I got another Oscar along with Richard Hymns. And that was, once again, a vote of confidence for our work. And I look back on those as, you know, obviously high points in terms of that part of my career.
This is a bolt of electricity that goes through the front of your body and comes shooting out the back, knocking most of your insides into the air. It's a big bloody effect, but with lightning instead of a bullet.
I just finished Star Wars, and actually I'd finished Empire, and so ILM had had a lot of experience and was really pretty much together in terms of doing special effects. So we had this great facility at our disposal on Indiana Jones to use to create a great environment and make the thing very exciting. It wasn't as special effects heavy as the Star Wars films were, but they special effects were just as important in terms of developing the milieu and the story and keeping the action going and making it very suspenseful.
And designing how these special effects would work and how they would have to be laid down in order to come out with the finished product was done in a combination between Steven, George, and everybody at ILM, led by Richard Edlands, our special effects supervisor.
We've been doing some experimental set work, you know, miniature. I don't know whether they've brought any of that over.
No, not yet.
Well, it's not quite successful yet, but I think they can make it work.
And then working with the mechanical effects with Kit West, it's a lot of coordination and collaboration here between several different departments to get the final shot. And the whole sequence, the climactic sequence in the movie, was very special effects oriented. And Steven had this very visual idea about these tendrils going through and what would happen when they would hit a body.
Yeah, but that's moving around too much, you see? You just want to do that, but in the same place.
Go on the count. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
We shot the long shots, basically. And then all the close-ups you see of them being wrapped by ghosts and things like that were shot at ILM. And when the beautiful angel comes up towards camera, that was shot with this model made up with lots of diffusion and material on the lens to make her look kind of fuzzy without being out of focus. And we shot in a water tank to make the veil float.
And the ghosts, you know, they were actually real little miniature ghosts, you know, with cloth and everything, but they shot them underwater in slow motion so that they would put them on little sticks and they'd sort of fly them around in this little windowed pool of water against a black background. And that gave them this kind of surreal, floaty feel. And that was, I think, one of the best effects, besides the heads blowing up and that sort of thing, which was relatively more traditional.
Tote, which is the most spectacular, you know, because he was the Nazi you loved to hate. Here's his head, as a matter of fact. So this is what's left. And basically this skull, we sculpted the muscles and the different layers of what would actually be in the face out of this dental alginate, the thing, the stuff that the dentist uses to take molds of your teeth. And then it was sculpted to look exactly like Tote. And using the heat lamp, and by putting heat on this alginate, it naturally melts. And by shooting at one frame a second, it appears to melt, but you don't see all the drops because they fall off and they're a blur. Then Wolf's face, basically it was hollow, and you just suck the air out of it.
And the exploding head was covered over by a large pillar of fire because the ratings board gave us an R based on the exploding head. So we had to negotiate for a PG rating by putting a large column of flame double exposed in front of the actual graphicness of the head coming apart.
On Raiders of the Lost Ark, I was involved only at the very beginning doing some tests about for doing the ghost sequence, but I did end up doing a little bit part in the movie. On Temple of Doom, I was the effects supervisor here at ILM, and we had a lot of sequences. We had the big mine chase sequence going through the tunnels. There was a great tunnel set that had been built full size that they could get quite a few shots off of. But when the camera pulled back and needed to see a lot of distance, then we came in with our model work.
We had some script pages that basically described what, you know, Steven had in mind, and then Steven invited us to come up with gags, basically, things that could happen. For instance, going over the lava flow and, you know, the ski jump. But as soon as we got storyboard pages from Steven, we built little sets using butcher paper and, you know, railroad cars, and took a video camera and shot a version of the sequence using this little video camera in this funky set just to see if it was going to play. And on the basis of that, Steven was able to eliminate certain gags that he didn't think were necessarily going to pay off and accept other ones.
Mm-hmm.
The budget on that film was fairly tight. We didn't have unlimited amount of money by any means. So the construction cost to build our miniature sets of the mine tunnels and everything, I figured out was actually based on how big the camera was.
And so what they did is they rigged a regular camera, regular still camera with a motor on it.
And taking the back out of the Nikon camera that pulls the film tight and put a movie shuttle in there and run movie film through it instead of still film.
And this little camera was on a little mine car just like the other one, and then one would follow right after the other. And it worked great.
And that meant because the camera now was only this big, our mine tunnels only need to be this big, like a foot across, and we could actually make them out of aluminum foil. So we just bought a lot of aluminum foil, crunkled it up to look like a mine tunnel, painted it to look like rock, and for $1.98, we got some great sets. And to then move the camera at a fast speed, we had to shoot really at a very slow speed. The camera was shooting one frame of film a second, so it was going very slowly along there. And that was fine for all the views looking ahead and looking back where nothing's going on. But there were scenes when you actually saw the characters that had to move. And those characters in there were then animated by Tom Sandemann using stop motion animation. So eventually the scene gets built up when you see it all together. It looked like continuous motion of a mine car. When they get lower down into the pit, we built a half-size model of Kate Capshaw and a half-size one of the slave, probably about 3 feet long or so, and then put them in a half-size model of the cage, and then had that actually lower down into our pretend lava.
And cut.
Cutting.
Okay, let's do another. Let's play one right away.
There were a lot of matte paintings in this movie. There's one that we have near the end when the heroes are walking and you see a massive, beautiful city out there. The heroes are actually double shot here in Marin, put into the painting, and coming out in the cliff face and the water suddenly starts pouring out. Some of that is a very large miniature we built, and then painting to go way off in the distance. That was quite an elaborate set we built also. We had a miniature tank probably about 20 feet in the air full of probably 5,000 gallons of water, and a cliff face that we had made and just had the water come from behind pouring out of this thing and then shot it at high speed so it looked like it was bigger than it really was.
Action on the plane!
Well, Last Crusade was another huge jump in responsibility for me because basically I was the supervisor for the whole film, and I was pretty green. I was just a kid, and that was a challenge.
And can we just pull the plane through by itself without the fire, please?
In those days, there was no such thing as digital fire. So if you had a sequence, especially a miniature sequence that involved fire, you pretty much were limited to actually shooting it as a miniature set. And that's indeed what we did. We had a miniature plane and we had miniature tunnels. And that was actually a pretty huge engineering feat to figure out, how to build the equipment to get the camera and the plane through the tunnel and get all the timing correct so that it exploded at the right place so you had a shot.
But at the same time, we have to really sell the idea that he's actually walked off this cliff and he's standing in the middle of the thing.
Well, look, let's just extend the cliff out to here.
That was the single most challenging concept in the movie, is how to actually tell that story that there's a bridge there, but you can't see it. It was sort of like the buck just got thrown to us and big smiles on everybody's faces because nobody else really knew how to do it. And it was a combination of matte painting type of talent on a miniature set. And so we built the set with the cliffs and everything, and we built a physical bridge that spanned the gap. And then from a certain camera position, Paul Houston would look through the camera and he would literally paint the bridge so that it blended into the background and was essentially invisible. And Paul's ability to create photoreal paintings that would hold up on the screen was really exceptional.
And that was one of the most interesting things ILM did, because you had to show the audience what it was. You know, when everything lines up, there's nothing there.
But when you start moving the camera to the right, we show the audience, just in one shot, illustrate to them that there was always a rock bridge to be crossed. So what are we doing today? We're doing all the skin falling off and revealing that, right?
Good.
Well,
basically, the assignment was to take a healthy man and turn him into dust in one shot. And the way that we went about doing that was to create three different puppets in different stages of decay, knowing that we could eventually morph the three puppets together. And then for the final skin decay, pasted all these little pieces of this shrinkable plastic onto the puppet, and then basically shoot in time-lapse photography and blow hot air at it. And so that became the foundation of all the skin decaying and falling off and looking horrific.
You know, I think a lot of the work we did then, or certainly all the work we did then, was before computers. And so you never had a chance to really fix the last two or three little things that didn't work, because you were always just trying to get anything that was close to working.
One of the reasons that the visual effects in this trilogy really hold up today is that the trilogy itself holds up. It's not a time-dependent story, and it's an adventure that's just, you know, captures people's imaginations no matter what generation you're from. And the visual effects really fit into the overall design and the overall idea of those stories.
I just fell in love with her immediately, because when I auditioned, I was given the scene in the bar where Indy comes in and I punch him in the jaw and you know, refuse to tell him that I have the medallion. And I just thought she was the best character I had ever read. I thought, can there be a better introduction to a character than sitting opposite this 300-pound mountain man in Nepal drinking him under the table? I was sort of in love with the character before I read the film. And I felt fiercely protective of her once we started shooting. I felt like I had this sort of sense of who she was, and I think, you know, as in action adventure films, often there will be a lot of scenes that are written and you don't know what the other characters are doing. So I would be in a scene that Indiana Jones was in, and maybe there wasn't much of a description of what Marion was doing in the scene. And I found that I often, you know, I just, whenever she was passive, or whenever there was a moment where nothing had been written, I just wanted her always to be on her toes, like ready to spring into action, ready to, you know, jump for the frying pan or the large object that she could smack somebody with. And so I guess, you know, that I do feel that I was given a little freedom to shape her, although I think that Stephen very much had a clear idea of who the character was and what he wanted from me. And I think it became, you know, an interesting collaboration between the two of us. I mean, I think there were times when I would fight for certain things and not, you know, win my way. And that, you know, there were times in which I was able to persuade him, you know, in a direction that was something that excited me about the character. So it was really, you know, for me, an interesting creative process to play her, to play Marion.
Kate. I found Willie Scott to be very, reading her, not very appealing. And I kept trying to figure out what was it that they saw in me that thought I could play that part? But it was so much fun to play this very annoying, petulant, arrogant, you know, just there wasn't a moment she was not, she was always uncomfortable. And the whining and the carrying on, Stephen was very, in fact, it's almost, I was going to say to a fault, not really, because he always keeps the picture very clear of the movie that he's making. But he's so generous with the actor, he allows, if you come up with an idea, he lets you do it. And so you almost have to be careful of the ideas you come up with, because he will let you do it and he will roll film. So if later you don't like it, it might end up in the movie. So he was very, he encouraged me. I love physical comedy, so almost every time we would have anything to do in terms of a scene, I was always trying to figure out how I could fall off, climb on backwards. I mean, all the physical stuff in the film was us standing there trying to figure out what to do that would amuse us. Because again, you are, you know, in hot climates and it's long filming hours, and you are ultimately trying to find something to amuse yourself. And so that was so much fun. So I think she was, for me, she ended up being a funnier girl than I had anticipated. So that was good.
I found Elsa Schneider very difficult because not only was I very young when I got the part, but I was really learning the business at the time, because I had no acting experience, really. I'd done some work, but I'd never studied acting. So it was all very surreal to me to even be in the film. And I...
And you were doing an accent?
The accent for me was hard, because I wanted my character to be attractive and sexy, and I found the accent really cold and hard, and it was hard for me to do all of that. But I was furious with Sean Connery, because I felt he had my part, you know, because, you know, it was the father-son relationship. I was going, that's meant to be me. And, you know, that's why I think the third actually worked really well, because you had that wonderful relationship between the two, father-son. But I can't say I found it easy. No, I didn't. I found it quite tough. And but looking back now, I mean, again, it was just all the action and everything else. But my character, I quite liked the fact that she goes from good to being totally obsessed herself, and being, you know, wanting the grail for herself and everything. But I did find it hard. Yeah.
I think that the intention was to, even though it's a damsel in distress at times element that runs through it, there's certainly distress, although, you know, it's a hero in distress as well. I think that it sort of played brilliantly with those things. And I think that Indiana Jones, too, is a very different kind of hero. I mean, he's the hero that puts on the German outfit and it's too small, and he's the hero that, you know, goes to hit somebody with something and the thing breaks, you know. So I think that, you know, it gets to play with the idea of what a hero and a heroine actually are in these films.
Willie Scott took a beating. I mean, she was not, I mean, when the film came out, there were so many people who didn't like her. She did not represent a strong female at all. She was, I mean, feminists just really came after Willie Scott. And there was no humor when they looked at her. So that perspective had been lost on me while we were doing it. I thought that because it was Saturday sort of matinee film, that we could play with like a stereotype, really. It was a stereotype, this woman. So she was treated much more seriously and not at all adored or appreciated or anything. And of course, and I told him when we were filming it, there was too much screaming. Don't think screaming's easy either.
No. I got an awful lot of scripts
that required Austrian accents, and after the movie, German parts came my way. But I thought it was interesting from the other two female leads. I thought it was a different character. I think Elsa Schneider certainly wasn't as heavily featured because Sean had my part. So it speaks for itself, and really it was in the script, and I didn't feel that I was going to be doing anything that was going down in history as standing up as, you know, I just did it. I was delighted to get it and paid the bills at home.
One of the great things about the Indiana Jones series is that we not only have this wonderful character of Indiana Jones, but he's surrounded by a whole group of fantastic characters, sidekicks, villains, heroines, and just wonderful characters that are not only great characters in the movies, but they're played by these fantastic and wonderful actors and actresses.
One of the premises with Indy was that he had lots of girlfriends. So when we did the first film, we were very fortunate to have Karen Allen, and she was very spunky and very tough in a very different way from Indiana Jones, but it made a great combination of characters there.
Well, you know, Marion was an entrepreneur. You know, she owned a bar, she had drinking contests. You know, she didn't need Indiana Jones to come back into her life. She was doing fine right where she was in Nepal. But any leading lady that greets a leading man with a huge power blow to the jaw is okay in my book.
The relationship was central to the movie. That romance, that fun, that antagonism, the back and forth, you know, the obvious affect love between them that is disguised by their irritation.
Where'd you get this, from him?
I was trying to escape, no thanks to you. I've never fired a gun before in my life.
Karen's feisty, she was a spitfire, and you know, she knew where she was in the world. She had a real center of gravity, and she was a real challenge for Indiana Jones.
This is Willie Scott. This is Indiana Jones, a famous archaeologist.
I think George's concept that he wasn't a one-woman man, and that he was essentially a charming rogue, and that these relationships were supposed to be relationships of the moment.
So you're an authority in that area?
Years of field work.
Oh.
I think he had a great interest in women, and I think sometimes that interest was interrupted by the adventure, and then the women can become a problem, you know, and he wonders, why are they along?
You're insulting them, and you're embarrassing me.
Water pouring off your face, and your hair very wet, and she'll be in a semi-conscious state where all she can do is
once
barely
again,
open her
Willie's
eyes.
Once again, looking very attractive.
Willie Scott's a showgirl. She's sort of a spoiled, you know, little rich girl that came out of the nightclub circuit. Someone that just was much better in front of a makeup mirror, and much better being primped and pampered and with adoring gentlemen in the audience clapping for her and giving her all sorts of reinforcement and support. And then she suddenly winds up in this huge adventure where the opposite happens to her.
I hate the water, and I hate being wet, and I hate you!
Good!
And that was where the comedy was, you know, especially the scene. I think my favorite Willie Scott scene is when the elephant tosses her off its back and she lands in the water and she does that really wonderful speech. I hate being outside. I'm a singer. I can use my voice. I love that line reading she did. She was like Harold Lombard for me. She was a comedienne, and she was great looking. And when you get that combination of a beautiful woman that can do comedy, God, that's rare.
Where's my gun?
I burnt my fingers and I can't. tractor nail!
My view of the Willie Scott character in Temple of Doom was that she was a great flirt, but I didn't think she slept around. Whereas the character in The Last Crusade was a real Mata Hari. She certainly had slept with Indiana Jones, and we later find out also slept with Indy's dad. You know, she was a spy. You know, she was a Nazi. She worked for the bad guys. And yet, there was also a place in her heart that didn't go all the way with the Nazi party, with the Third Reich. And then she showed her vulnerability and tried to convince Indy that she was really on his side and she wasn't really that much of a bad guy. And Indy never bought it.
I believe in the Grail, not the swastika.
You stood up to be counted with the enemy of everything that the Grail stands for. Who gives a damn what you think?
You do!
Allison did a really, really good job. You know, she was very effective, and she knew how to play these guys off of each other, and she could also embrace the comedy, which I liked about her.
How dare you kiss me?
Where shall I find a new adversary so close to my own level?
Try the local sewer.
It's been said that a hero is really only as good as its villain. And certainly we have great villains in the Indiana Jones series. I think what sets them apart is that they come from a historical background, that they are based on historical characters, but they're very stylish, and we have wonderful actors playing them.
We worked very hard to create great villains, and we usually have a couple of them so that they can play off each other, so it'll group.
The movies are pretty much balanced with a champagne villain. Look at Belloc in Raiders of the Lost Ark, and then look at the two henchmen behind him, which is Dietrich and Tote, played by, the great, late Ronald Lacey. And Wolf Collar played Dietrich, and he was very, very effective. And so you have the good cop, bad cop in terms of villain.
Stop it!
The duel was mine! She's of no use to us, only our mission for the Führer matters.
Belloc, to me, is the villain. You know, he's the real antagonist. And what the Nazis do is that they're an all-purpose backup to him because he's a gentleman, because he's smooth. That kind of villain can do everything. He can do his evil, he can pursue the object, and he can seduce the girl, you know. And so, but it's a kind of smooth villain that needs real dark, extreme backup. And that's what Tote and all the Germans are, you know.
And then in The Last Crusade, you've got the champagne villain, Donovan, and then you have the bad Nazi. And they, form a very, very good counterbalance. But it was always fun to pick on the Nazis because you sort of got a get-out-of-jail-free card when the Nazis were the villains. And it fell right into line with a lot of these old serials where the Nazis were the villains. But we got into a little more controversy when we made this Cali cult the villains because people thought we were attacking Eastern Indians, which we weren't. You know, we simply chose a cult from ancient history to be, which is, by the way, the same cult that was chosen by George Stevens in Gunga Din.
Holy smoke, my friends! I'm so pleased you're not dead!
There's always got to be these great sidekicks. Sidekicks are a kind of Hollywood constant. And Sala was a perfect sidekick for Indiana Jones.
Belloc's staff is too long.
They're digging in the wrong place.
And then we had Denham Elliott, who played Marcus Brody.
He's hysterical with pleasure, of course, isn't he? I mean,
Marcus is one of those secondary characters who supplies an enormous amount of the exposition for us. And also tells us about Indy and what is his character.
So she'll still be with him?
Possibly, but Marion's the least of your worries right now, believe me, Indy.
But he stayed at school, he stayed at Marshall College, and so we brought him into the field for the first time in The Last Crusade. And he was a really funny actor. He had great comic chops, so he and Sala together were kind of like a comedic tag team.
Yeah. Egyptian Mail, morning edition, run!
Did you say,
run! Ready to go?
Ready to go, that's it!
For the Temple of Doom, rather than having the standard sidekick, it was really a very sort of ingenious idea to do it as this little boy, this insightful, tough little boy. I mean, we had discussed doing it as a little girl, But then we thought, you know, this is kind of inappropriate. So, I mean, the little boy emerged, and I think he's just, you know, a survivor in a very tough world. And it comes across with a lot of humor and generosity.
I'm very little. You, she's very big.
This little kid who had never acted before was brilliant. He was the ultimate sidekick. I mean, he gets to say great things back and forth. He gets to annoy him.
Bye, buddy.
It's like R2-D2. I mean, it's a little thing that fits into the action really brilliantly.
Hey, Dr. Jones, no time for love. We got company.
I wasn't surprised they were making a fourth Indy because I know how much they all enjoy doing it.
I'm looking forward to the Indy 4 to fulfill all those pleasures that the series gives.
First of all, there's the great hero that Harrison plays. There's the love interests. There's the sidekicks. There's the action. I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
Have you? Professor of archaeology, expert on the occult, and how does one say it? Obtainer of rare antiquities.
Indiana Jones. Always knew someday you'd come walking back through my door.
When I was done with Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, there was a reason that I invented the shot of Harrison riding a horse into the sunset, because I thought that brought the curtain down on the trilogy, and then we were all going to move on and mature into other aspects of filmmaking, and I never thought I would ever see Indiana Jones again, which, by the way, in a sweet, nostalgic way, was fine with me at the time. But there were some people it wasn't fine with. And I think it started with the fans. And I really think that the first rumblings we heard was about 5 years later. And I was off, you know, doing a publicity tour on a movie I had directed. But I just remember people asking me, when are you making the next Indiana Jones? Now that question followed me everywhere I went in this country and overseas. I'd get asked the question, inevitably, sometimes not even on camera, are you going to make another Indiana Jones picture? And that was a question that was not only asked of me, but it was asked of Harrison. And I know it was asked of George Lucas. All of us have been asked that question. Harrison was the person that took it seriously. And he finally called me and said, why don't we make one of these pictures? There's a fan base out there that wants it. And my attitude was always, oh, I've moved on and you've moved on and I'm making these historical dramas and that sort of thing. And Harrison was tenacious, and Harrison called George and got George thinking about it. Then George called me, and he said, well, Steve, what do you want to do? It could be fun to make another movie. And I was the holdout. I was the one that said, I'm done with this series. It was great. Let's walk away. And I have to give the credit to Harrison for starting the ball rolling, and then for George in working on me to get me to consider the possibility of more stories, or at least one more story.
There was an ongoing dialogue. There was a period of maybe 5 or 6 years where nobody anticipated doing another. And then we began to, each of us in our way, to think about the potential, the possibility of doing another. Having been out in the world making all kinds of other movies, I was happy to do another Indiana Jones film just because they're so much damn fun.
And then in 2000, there was an AFI tribute to Harrison. And we were all sitting there in our tuxedos, and we were watching on the screen, and we were seeing all these great clips, and people were telling wonderful stories. And we sat around afterwards, and we said, you know, that was really fun. Maybe we ought to do another one, and we really ought to focus on this. And that's how it happened.
One of the things that I was worried about was when we made these movies, we captured lightning in a bottle. So one of the things that struck me, though, as a concern was, will the audience accept Harrison? Because when we first began talking about making another one of these pictures, Harrison was in his mid-50s. And now he's in his mid-60s, as Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull is about to open. And that was a concern for me. It was a concern when he was 55. Is he too old to play Indiana Jones? And he wasn't at 55. And by the way, he sure ain't at 65. And I'm sure he's got another 10 years left in him if he wants to do something like this again. Because Harrison was the secret weapon. And it made me realize that Harrison was the center of this piece from the very beginning. The casting of that man to play that role was the most important thing we did. And when I realized that the strength of Indiana Jones is the way we fashion this for Harrison, that was the key for all of us.
You're a teacher?
Part-time.
George Lucas had this idea for Indiana Jones, and it was basically, hey, let's do aliens. And I said, George, I don't want to do aliens. I've done two alien movies. At the time, I had done E.T. and Close Encounters of the Third Kind, not in that order, but I had done both of those pictures. And I didn't want to do any more aliens. That was it. But George insisted, and he didn't. He said, this will be like a B-movie. It'll be like those 1950s B-movies, Earth versus Flying Saucers, and all those exploitation movies that were really about government paranoia, Cold War fears and things like that, and Hollywood turned them into Invaders from Mars.
It was the idea of taking the genre from the 1930s serials, action-adventure serials, to the B science fiction movies of the 50s, in the early 50s. And I said, if we move the whole thing into the 50s, which would be age-appropriate for Harrison, that would be the cinematic equivalent. And I wanted to rest it on a cinematic antecedent like we did with the other one.
And I resisted, but I also never thought I'd be making Indiana Jones 4. So I kind of humored George by going along with it, thinking, well, I'll never wind up directing this movie, though. I'll wind up producing it with George and somebody else. We'll get some young kid to come in and do this, you know. And then when we actually began to get close to a story involving extraterrestrials, Independence Day came out, which was a smash. And I said to George, I called George up after I saw the movie, said, hey, this movie's really a lot of fun. It's brilliantly directed by Roland Emmerich. It's just got everything you want in a movie. It's got humor and it's got drama. It's got things you've never seen before. It's got a mothership bigger than my mothership in Close Encounters hovering over a city in broad daylight. I said, come on, we can't do aliens, especially since Roland has done his alien picture.
I then sort of thought, well, maybe I could do a kind of, you know, there's a whole genre of ancient civilizations developed by aliens. And I said, well, maybe I can move it into that, you know, without flying saucers and see if that would work.
So then George came to me one day, I'll never forget this conversation, said, you know, you might be right about this alien thing. Maybe we shouldn't do aliens. There's too much of that stuff around. I said, George, I love you. That's the best news you've ever given me. He said, yeah, they're not aliens. They're kind of extra-dimensional. I said, what? He said, ever hear a string theory about different dimensions? I said, yeah. He said, okay, these are interdimensional beings. They're not extraterrestrials. They're interdimensional. So I said, fine. And what are they going to look like? George said, look like aliens, but we'll call them interdimensional. But at that point, I thought that was kind of interesting. It kind of deepened the subject matter a little bit.
So once I started that, then we started getting on the right track and getting the script in shape, and then it finally became what it is. But it's been a kind of long road to get everybody to agree, and we're not going to do the movie unless all three of us agree on it.
So then I had this idea to bring in Jeff Nathanson, who had done two scripts for me, and he put some really good ideas together and gave us some guidance, some direction, especially on the story. He really brought some original elements to the story, and of course he has a story by credit that he shares with George, which I'm very happy about. But what I did later on was I went to who I call my closer, David Koepp, who has written a number of films, starting with Jurassic Park and Lost World. David wrote War of the Worlds, which I directed, and he's an accomplished director himself. And so I went to David and I said, David, I need help. And then he wrote the script that became the movie.
You kind of have to approach this movie as if the others never happened, but in the back of your mind realize that the rules were laid out previously and you still have to stick by them. So it's a bit of a balancing act, you know, and my feeling was I want to be respectful, I want to be mindful, but I also have to write something as if for the first time, you know, so try to have the audience in your head but not have them in your head. It's a real tricky line that you got to walk.
I think David's sense of humor is the key to the way that he writes. I think that's what makes his characters so endearing and accessible and entertaining. So the fact that he also has this incredible ability to write action and understand, you know, the structure of how that works and how you build upon action and how you make things more exciting and suspenseful and all of those things. At the end of the day, it's all about the characters.
One of the things that I'm excited about is Marion Ravenwood.
Indiana Jones. About time you showed up.
Mom.
Sweetheart, what are you doing here?
Forget about me. Are you all right?
Mom. Young man, I specifically told Marion you not Ravenwood. To come down what? Here yourself.
It was so great to work with Karen again after all these years. She hadn't changed a bit.
I always knew one day you'd come walking back to my campfire.
She is the same feisty Marion Ravenwood as she was when we released the picture in 1981.
I learned to hate you in the last 10 years. I had heard rumors that this film was in the works for years and years and years. So somewhere in the back of my mind, I thought, wouldn't it be great if they were going to do a fourth one? And wouldn't it be fantastic if they brought my character back into it? But I can't say that I really, you know, believed that that was going to happen. So I'm just, actually, I was at my studio one day, and the telephone rings, and I pick it up. And I hear somebody on the phone going, I've got Steven Spielberg on the line for you. And he said, I guess you know why I'm calling. And I said, no, I don't. And he said, what, haven't you been watching television? Haven't you been reading the papers? And I said, no. And he said, we've just announced we're making the next one. And your character, you're going to be in it. We really want you to be in it. And I had sort of imagined maybe it would be a wonderful little cameo or something, but he told me how, you know, what a major role he wanted my character and me to play in the film. And when I read the script, honestly, I was just like very, very moved by it, by, you know, what they had done with the character and the wonderful kind of repartee between them as they sort of, you know, mend fences and sort of realize that they still love each other. And yeah, I just thought it was beautiful.
Honey, you gotta stop. We're gonna go off the cliff.
That's the idea.
Bad idea. Give me the wheel.
Trust me.
Marion remains as independent and strong as she ever was.
That, you never wrote any of that.
Marion Ravenwood is your mother.
For God's sake, Indy, it's not that hard.
And a lot of the comic fodder comes out of their relationship. And also out of the process of the revelation of his fatherhood.
He's a good kid, Marion. You should get off his back about school.
Mutt,
not everybody's cut out for it.
His name is Henry.
Henry, good name.
He's your son.
My son.
In the beginning, it was a daughter he didn't know about. And I thought that'd be a great thing. Stephen actually didn't like that idea. And so David revisited the idea again as a son, and then this time we approached him with it. He sort of said, okay.
My name's Mutt Williams.
Mutt? Mm. What kind of name is that?
That's the one I picked. You got a problem with it?
In the beginning, it was approached kind of as he was a nerd. You know, he's kind of a straight-laced kid that wore suits and things. And then later on, we decided that that isn't really the way it should work. It should work that he's the wild kid, which is what Indy was to his father.
Dad! It's important.
Wait.
No, Dad, you listen.
Junior!
So, just like he was to his father, that's kind of going off and doing all the wrong things and disobeying and doing all this stuff, now Indy's faced with the same mess.
Get on, Gramps!
You know, the curse returns in the form of his son.
So, what are you, like 80?
I always liked the fact that his name's Mutt, and, you know, his father figures were kind of being switched in and out of his life. And so now you got a kid who never really had a stable father, who had a mother who lived a really intense life, never really had a normal upbringing. He's kind of lost. The way Steven always explained it to me was like man boy, where you got this person who on the outside is trying to present himself as something that he's really not. I'm a man, you know, look at this knife, look at this bike. I'm a man, look at it, you know? And it's never that simple.
I'm ready. Don't give these pigs a thing.
Clearly, I've chosen the wrong pressure point. Perhaps I can find a more sensitive one.
We couldn't do Nazis again, and I wouldn't have done that anyway. But because of the 50s, the other thing about the 50s was the Cold War. And the Red Menace, as it used to be known in America, and the threat of nuclear annihilation, nuclear intimidation, that was something that was in the headlines every single day. And so the Russians got the job.
Russians,
this ain't gonna be easy.
Not as easy as it used to be.
The skull was stolen from Akator in the 15th century. Whoever returns it to the
city temple will gain control over its powers. I've heard that bedtime story before.
What the Indiana Jones movies have always done really well is play with existing mythology and bend it to their storytelling purposes, you know? So everything in it is drawn from real mythology.
There may be hundreds of skulls at Akator, perhaps thousands. Whoever finds them will control the greatest natural force the world has ever known. Power over the mind of man.
You know, there are crystal skulls, you know, and there are large groups of people that believe all these things. So, could be true, could be not, we don't know. But the closer you can stick to real legends, the better the movie's gonna work, I think.
A mind weapon. A new frontier of psychic warfare. That was Stalin's dream.
There was a lot of history about the Russians having a big program about mind control, ESP, all of those disciplines were researched to try to see if they could figure out other ways of having secret weapons. So that was very big in Russia, and we used that.
Imagine to peer across the world and know the enemy's secrets, to place our thoughts into the minds of your leaders. And the best part? You won't even know it's happening.
Well, the original title on the original script was Indiana Jones and the Saucerman, and that's what I wanted it to be. And then it went from there to things even like Indiana Jones and the Attack of the Giant Ants.
I said, hey, let's call this Indiana Jones and the yada yada of the Mysterians, until I realized, wait, we can't call it that. There was a movie called The Mysterians, so we had to give that up.
I really, for a long time, thought the movie should be called Indiana Jones and the Son of Indiana Jones. That was my bright idea, but not really.
David Koepp had written out 25 titles. George wrote out some, I wrote out some, and the three of us basically came to the conclusion that, you know, Indiana Jones and the Kingdom, which was a word George insisted on using, of the Crystal Skull was the right balance of mystery and being able to embrace our MacGuffin. But, you know, all the traditions of Indiana Jones are back again. I wasn't trying to reinvent the wheel here. I wasn't trying to make this movie bigger or better. I wanted this to be a blood relative to the other three Raiders pictures. And I just think that we created Indiana Jones, but it belongs to the world. And now we're their custodians. And our job really is to serve up a huge helping of not only what Indiana Jones means to older people who grew up with it, but we need to reintroduce the character to those who didn't. And so those are my responsibilities.
I miss the desert. I miss the sea. And I miss waking up every morning, wondering what wonderful adventure the new day will bring to us.
Those days have come and gone.
Perhaps. Perhaps not.
I don't believe in magic. But a few times in my life, I've seen things. Things I can't explain. And I've come to believe it's not so much what you believe. It's how hard you believe it.
Mrs. Mutt.
I'm her godfather.
Mildly related.
Get back!